invite you to follow along with me today closely. It will not be long. Our scripture text for today. Let's look at Revelation chapter 3, beginning with verse 14. I want to kind of link this scripture text with our passage of scripture reading done by the Campbell today. Revelation chapter 3, verse 14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things said the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou were cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increase with goods and have need of nothing, I knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold in, tried in fire, that thou mayest be rich. Right raiment, that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear. And anoint thine eye with eyesalve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame, and I am sit down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Today I want to speak on the topic, the sealing of the remnant. Shall we? Father, without your Spirit we can not understand your word. So Father, take control of our hearts and our minds and our thoughts. Take control of the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart. Speak to us. May we not only be hearers, but more important, may we be obedient. Amen. We thank you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Have you ever been in a situation where you thought that you were good at something only to find out that you were not good enough? I remember when I first joined the track and field team at my high school in, you know, right here in Brooklyn, George W. Wingate High School. And I shared the story with you once before that I was good. At least I thought I was good. I used to run pretty well. And, I used to be like this guy in Jamaica. Yes. I used to be fast. But long distance running was my specialty. You would not know it, of course, if you look at me now. But I thought I was good initially. bit on Trinidad.
Amen.
And I remember when I had my first competition. We used to compete with all the other high schools in our district, about 10 different high schools, and the first competitive race we had was in Prospect Park, and it was a 3-mile run, and I really thought I was prepared to be among the, you know, those who will finish in the first, at least in the top, if not the first. And I remember when we lined up, must have been about 100 of us, and the referee, or the umpire, whoever you call him, he said, "On your march, get set, and shoot the gun in the air," the fake gun. And everyone just shoot off, you know. And, you know, I was really surprised when all these guys just shoot off so fast. I said to myself, look, you know, they, pretty soon I'm going to be taking them over because they're not pacing themselves, and I'm going to catch up with them soon and beat them. But, you know, beloved, I never did catch up with them. These guys were good. And by the time I, next time I saw them was at the finish line. I finished not in the first half, but I finished in the bottom half. I was not good at, as I thought. I needed to step up, you know. I needed to step up my game, so to speak. Or I needed to step up. And, you know, we all have experiences like these. Some of us, I remember even when I went to Andrews University, coming from Oakwood College, taking all these classes that I thought were difficult. But when I got to Andrews University, beloved, one class was equivalent to 4 classes that I took in Oakwood College. The work that I needed to do in one class was equivalent to the work I did in 4 classes at Oakwood. And I needed to step up, meet the challenge. And I didn't know how I was going to do it, but praise the Lord, His grace has brought me through. I'm saying this, beloved, because I see that this is kind of the same situation with Laodicea. Laodicea is the final church that will exist just before the 4 angels let loose the winds of strife upon the earth.
Yes.
Laodicea is the last church that would exist just before the time of trouble. We read in Daniel chapter 12, right? Verse 1 says, "For there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation upon the face of the earth." And Laodicea is that church that thinks that she is ready for the final crisis, but only to find out too late that she was lacking. She was not prepared to face the test. She thought that she was good. She thought that she was okay, not realizing that she needed to step up. Laodicea needed needed to have something that was necessary to help her meet the challenge, but she did not have it. And because she did not have what it took, she had no choice but to step out. And this is why we are told that a remnant out of the remnant will be saved. What will be the issue in the time of trouble? What is it that Laodicea need to overcome in order to successfully meet this great final conflict? I believe that in this great tribulation, God's people will have to reproduce the victory that Jesus won on the cross. What do I mean? Three times, Satan tempted Jesus to come down from the cross and save himself. Once, through the Roman soldiers. Another time, through the Jewish priests. And the third time was through the thief at his left side. Using his divine power independently of the Father, Christ could have left the cross and saved himself. But he did not. He hung on the cross and faced this last terrible temptation. It was by faith, not feelings, that Jesus Christ overcame.
Amen.
His feelings told him that his Father had forsaken him. But by faith, he believed God would never do that. By faith, Jesus was victorious. In the same way, during the time of trouble, our faith will be tested to the limit. And beloved, believe me, the way things are going now in our world, the time of trouble is not far. And we will feel abandoned by God. We will feel that we are without hope. But by faith, we will cling to God's promises and overcome. Those whose faith endures unto the end are known in Revelation as the 144,000. These are those in Laodicea who overcame even as Christ overcame. Isaiah gives us insight into the issues in this time of trouble. God says to Isaiah in Isaiah chapter 54, verse 7 and 8. God says through Isaiah, "For a small moment have I forsaken thee, but with great mercy will I gather thee. In a little wrath I hid my face from thee, for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer.
Amen.
Isaiah 54, verse 7 and 8. We will feel apparently forsaken by God during the time of trouble. In this final showdown, God will say, here are my people who have the faith of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And the devil will challenge God. Give them into my hands. Let's see how faithful they will be. God's reply, you can touch them. You can do anything to them, but you cannot kill them. We will be at the mercy of the world, which will be fully controlled by Satan. The question is, will there be a people whose faith, like that of Jesus on the cross, will endure until the very end? That is the question. And the good news is that the answer is yes.
Amen.
They are called 144,000 and are pictured in only two passages in the entire New Testament, Revelation 7 and Revelation 14. Revelation 7 is answering the question asked in the last verse of chapter 6. In Revelation chapter 6, that last verse, the question is asked, the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? Revelation 7 answers that question. No one, it seems, is able to stand the second coming of Christ. So the question is asked, who is able to stand? Is anyone able? The answer is found in chapter 7, and the answer is yes. God will have a people who will be able to stand.
Amen.
Verse 1 pictures four angels holding back the four winds that are about to blow on the earth and the sea and the trees. Winds symbolizes strife and war. At the end time, God says to Satan, here are my people. Satan says, give them into my hands and let me test them. God says, not yet. I will protect my people and hold back the winds of strife. Hold back the great tribulation. I will hold it back until my people are sealed in their foreheads.
Amen.
Beloved, that is why trouble has not come upon this world as yet. That is why trouble after trouble has not come yet. Because the angel of God is holding back the winds of strife, the passion of men. Waiting so that God's people may be sealed in their foreheads. What does the sealing mean in Romans chapter 4? Paul in Romans chapter 4 gives us an example of the meaning of sealing. In Romans chapter 4, the Apostle Paul argues with the Jewish Christians in Rome. He argues with them that circumcision does not contribute in the least to their salvation. That's the argument Paul is arguing with them. are you them, letting them know that circumcision does not contribute to their salvation. But the Apostle Paul anticipates a question that the Jews in Rome will ask him. And therefore the Apostle Paul answered that question and he said, if circumcision has no significance for our salvation, why did God give it to Abraham and to his descendants? Paul answers his question. He said, Abraham received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had yet been circumcised. Abraham, the Apostle Paul is saying, Abraham had righteousness by faith long before he was circumcised. Circumcision did not contribute anything to Abraham's righteousness. It did something else, Paul says. Circumcision sealed what Abraham already had. Circumcision confirmed the righteousness that Abraham already possessed. This is important because the seal of God in the last days is not circumcision, but it is what? The Sabbath. The Sabbath is the seal. Like circumcision, Sabbath keeping does not make us righteous. It does not contribute anything to our salvation. It only seals something that is already there.
Amen.
The significance of circumcision and of the Sabbath are synonymous in this regard. Both are signs of an experience, and that experience is righteousness by faith. The sealing of God's people in these last days simply means that their faith in the Lord of the Sabbath has become unshakable.
Yeah.
They have settled into the truth of Jesus Christ, our righteousness. They have purchased the white raiment from Christ and have made that their only hope. Then there is then no turning back, beloved. No turning back to self. Once God's people have been sealed, they have come to understand God's character, his love and his mercy, and his work of redemption so clearly that their faith is unshakable, unchangeable. They are resting in him. This is the sealing. And the Sabbath is the sign of that experience. God's people are sealed in their foreheads, indicating that they have the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ was an attitude that was totally emptied of self. When God's people are sealed, there will be no more wavering. There will be no more sinning. It is in this context that Christ will say, he that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. These are the two camps. God's people and Satan followers. Both have their minds made up. And therefore both have been sealed. Satan followers are sealed with what? The mark of the beast in their foreheads. And God's people are sealed with the seal of God. Jesus was sealed in Gethsemane. It was there that he made up his mind. Christ made up his mind beyond any changing. He was not going to change his mind. He had made up his mind in the Garden of Gethsemane that he was going to go all the way.
Amen.
He did struggle there in the garden, didn't he?
Yes.
Three times he prayed that prayer. Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Three times, beloved, he went back and he prayed that prayer. Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He did not want to go through. But he prayed also, nevertheless, not
my will.
My will. Jesus. Be done.
Amen. Glory to God.
He submitted himself to the will of the Father. He made up his mind that he will go all the way.
All the way.
That he will put his faith in his Father. Calvary, Jesus Christ carried out the decision of that sealing experience. The great tribulation will be a test whether our faith is unshakable and whether we will overcome even as Christ overcame. The Bible pictures those who are sealed as the 144,000. They have experienced total victory. They have overcome, even as Christ overcame.
Yes.
Ellen White made a few comments in regard to the sealing experience of the 144,000, those who will be sealed in these last days. She said that those that overcome the world, the flesh and the devil will be the favored ones who shall receive the seal of the living God. Those whose hands are not clean, whose hearts are not pure, will not have the seal of the living God. Those who are planning sin and acting it will be passed by. Only those who in their attitude before God fill in the position of those who are repenting and confessing their sins in the great anti-typical day of atonement will be recognized and marked as worthy of God's protection. The names of those who are steadfastly looking and waiting and watching for the appearing of their Savior more earnestly and wishfully than they that do wait for the morning will be numbered with those who are sealed.
Amen.
Those who, while having all the light of truth flashing upon them, their souls, should have works corresponding to their avowed faith, but allured by sin, setting up idols in their hearts, corrupting their souls before God, and polluting those who unite with them in sin, will have their names blotted out of the book of life and be left in midnight darkness, having no oil in their vessels with their lamps. Now, she said, it's a time to prepare. The seal of God will never be placed upon the forehead of an impure man or woman. It will never be placed upon the forehead of the ambitious, world-loving man or woman. It will never be placed upon the forehead of men or women of false tongues or deceitful hearts. All who receive the seal must be without spot before God, candidates for heaven. So we see, beloved, the Jewish people, even though circumcision was a sign Even though circumcision was, as it were, a seal indicating that they have been made righteous by faith, yet there were many of them who were keeping the Sabbath, yet who were not righteous. Many of them who were circumcised, so to speak, and they still were not righteous. But yet, for them, circumcision was that seal of righteousness. But many of them who were circumcised, they still were not righteous. Even so, with God's people today, the Sabbath is that seal of righteousness by faith. But yet, there will be many who will be keeping the Sabbath up until the plagues, but who have not been made righteous. Keeping the Sabbath, and even though the Sabbath is a seal of the righteousness, yet they are not made righteous because something is missing. Missing the mark. Beloved, I believe that more than ever before, we must have that faith. Yes, the faith of Jesus. The faith that brought him through his experience. That faith that we need in order for us to overcome, even as he overcame. The time of trouble will be terrible. Our imagination cannot begin to conjure up how terrible it will be. Normally, our imagination magnifies potential problems, and in the reality is much, much less severe. But in this case, that will not be so. Only indication we have of the severity of the time of trouble, of the trial that we will face, is the tribulation which Christ experienced on the cross. Like Jesus Christ, we will feel forsaken of God. The devil will take advantage of these feelings to whisper to us, do you know why God has forsaken you? Because you're lost. He has abandoned you because there is no hope of salvation for you. And beloved, your feelings will confirm what Satan is saying. Your feelings will tell you that there is no hope for you. Yet, your faith will say,
yes.
I believe Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
He has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you.
Yes, sir.
My righteousness is not in me, but in Jesus.
Yes.
I will trust him. Though the heavens fall.
Amen.
Amen.
This is what will take us through the faith of Jesus.
Amen.
The real issue, beloved, during the time of trouble will be righteousness by faith.
Amen.
Not sinless living. Yes, we all have to overcome in order to meet that crisis before we are sealed. But the issue is, how do we overcome? It is only by the faith of Christ.
Amen.
We will be made righteous by faith. But when we are being made righteous, we will not know it. We will not feel it. Because we are still living in a body. You know, has a sinful nature. And the devil will use our sinful nature against us. And that is where our faith will have to trust in God 100%. The great issue in the time of trouble will not be sinless living. We will not be conscious of living sinlessly. We will always feel like we are unworthy sinners. The great issue will be, are you willing to rest in Christ, the Lord of the Sabbath?
Yes.
Even though you feel forsaken by God and undeserving of heaven, God will have a faithful people who will overcome. Just as the Savior overcame by faith.
Amen.
We need to overcome unbelief. We need to overcome self-righteousness. This is Laodicean problem. Self-righteousness. We think that we are rich and increase in goods. Nor is not that we are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, naked. We need to buy gold tried in fire. That is faith. We need eyesight that we may see. That is the Holy Spirit. We need the white raiment. That is the righteousness of Christ.
Amen.
So we do have a problem, self-righteousness. We think that we are okay. We think that we are ready for the race. We think that we are going to make it into heaven. But too late, beloved. Laodicea found out that too late, that she was not ready. She was not ready for the test, and she found that out too late. And that is why God is speaking to his people now. Now is the time for us to prepare ourselves. At least when I used to run, beloved, I had more than one chances to, you know, to step up and to win a couple of races, which I did in the future. But with Laodicea, beloved, there will not be a second chance. The race, the trial that we will face, the great time of trouble, there will not be a second chance for us to step up. Now is the time for us to have our robes made white in the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
Now is the time for us to have that faith. Yes, even the faith of Christ. This is what God is calling his people. Revelation chapter 14 and verse 12 tells us that here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the what? Faith of Jesus Christ. So we are not called to just have faith in Jesus Christ, but God's people are called to have the faith of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
That faith that took him all the way to Calvary. That faith that made himself declare in Gethsemane, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That is the faith of Jesus. And that is the faith that God's people must have in these last days.
Amen.
We do not get that faith, beloved. We do not get that faith But we get that faith, beloved, only in Christ.
Amen.
Only as we surrender to the message of Christ, our righteousness, will we be able to stand in these time of trouble. Time of trouble is coming, but God will give us victory.
Amen.
Victory must begin today. May God, beloved, may he help us. Give us that faith. That faith that is so strong. That we will have not only faith in him, but we will have the faith of Jesus.
Amen.
Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. For it is God which worketh in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure.
Amen.
Beloved, here at Beacon of Light, we want everyone to make it into God's
kingdom.
Amen.
And that is why, beloved, we bring before you so often the uplifted Jesus, the sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He is our righteousness. He is the one who will prepare us to stand in the time of trouble.
Amen.
If any one of us falter, it is because we did not receive his righteousness. That righteousness that he is offering, we need to surrender our heart wholly and completely to him. And today, if you will hear his voice, harden not your heart.
Amen.
He wants to live in us today.
Amen.
He wants to impute and impart his righteousness in our hearts.
Amen.
Unless God's righteousness, the righteousness of Christ, which is also his agape love, unless that floods our being, unless that floods our heart, beloved, we will have no part with him. We will overcome. Fear will cause us to overcome. It is only when love is perfected in our hearts, fear will be removed. It's only when the righteousness of Christ, his faith, comes in. That faith must be motivated by his agape love. When that comes into our heart, then we will be victorious, and only then will we be sealed and be ready for the time of
trouble.
Amen.
God help us to be faithful and to believe his word, trust in Jesus, so that he will be overcomers. God bless you, and God keep us all
in
his life.